So, well, first of all, let me thank the organizers for inviting me. And, well, I should say that I'm a PhD student at Complutense University in Madrid. My advisor is Miguel Ángel Martín Delgado. And I want to talk about our work on topological color codes, which is contained in a series of papers where we describe two-dimensional and three-dimensional codes, connections with condensed matter, statistical models, and so on. So this is the outline. First, I will recall the idea of transversal gates and topological codes in general. Then we'll describe certain color codes, triangular codes in particular, which will allow us to perform transversal Clifford gates. And later, we'll discuss three-dimensional color codes and how they can be used to get universal quantum computation transversally. And if I have time, I will say something about topological order also. So, well, I will not give the definition of a stabilizer code here. I just want to recall that some stabilizer codes are especially suitable for quantum computation because they allow to perform certain gates in a transversal and uniform way. This means that we have our code blocks encoded in qubits. These are our basic or physical qubits. And then I can perform certain encode unitaries, or this encode qubits, by just applying certain one-qubit gates to each, the same one to each of my qubits in the code. And similarly for two-qubit gates with pairwise operations. Then, this is not only useful in the view of fault tolerance quantum computation, but also it's interesting from the point of view of implementations, because if I can perform my gates in such a transversal uniform way, then I don't have to address specifically qubit or that qubit. I could just employ some external field and just apply the same gate on all of them without having to address them in that specific way. Now, which gates can I implement transversally? Well, there are several codes which allow the transversal implementation of the Clifford group. In particular, its generators are this Hadamard, this PhaseGate gate, and the CNOT gate. They are quite useful and arise naturally in stabilizer codes, but what is not so nice is that they are almost classical and that they are not enough for universal computation. Then, there exists a class of very interesting codes, Rettmuller codes, which allow universal computation through transversal gates, in particular this, the square of K and the CNOT gate, using transversal measurements of X and Z. Then, my point is that these sets of operations can be transversally implemented in certain topological codes, in particular Clifford operations in two dimensions and these Rettmuller-like gates in three dimensions. So these are certain topological codes with interesting classes of transversal gates. Oops, sorry. Now, so what do we mean for topological stabilizer codes? Well, first of all, we certainly will need a topological space, whatever it is. Just a place where we have an idea of locality, spatial locality. Then we place our qubits in this space and choose a particular stabilizer code. And then when do we say that this stabilizer code is topological? Well, if the generators of this stabilizer are local in this sense, for example, we'll have generators that will look like this, will act on a neighborhood of my topological space, and at the same time, non-detectable errors will have a global nature, or so to say, a topological nature. So here, they will look something like this. This is the support of some non-detectable error. And what is special about this support is that in this case, it encloses one of the holes of the of these two torus. This is something which you cannot do locally. If you have a local operator, it will never go around the hole. So this is the relationship between global and, so to say, topological properties. So. Now, usually, we don't consider very strange topological spaces, but just surfaces. And then, also usually, the stabilizer will be composed of boundaries and the normalizer of cycles. So for example, in surfaces, my operators will have the shape of strings. Then a string is a boundary if it encloses some area of the surface. So this would not be a boundary because this does not enclose any area. And for a cycle, I will mean a string which has no endpoint, so it must be closed. So for example, this would be a cycle which is not a boundary, and those are going to be my non-detectable errors. Of course, there is a relationship between this set of cycles which are not boundaries and homology groups, but, well, I will not enter into this. Then, as you know, when working with stabilizer codes, it's enough to measure certain check operators in order to perform error correction. In the case of topological codes, these check operators are going to be local, which is very nice. And in particular, we will be able to construct arbitrarily robust codes, I mean, codes of arbitrarily large distance, while our generators remain local and with of a fixed support. So for example, if they have a support of 4 qubits, this will be true whatever the size of my surface. So they will always look the same locally. Another interesting feature is that apparently it turns out that the best strategy to perform error correction within topological codes is to continuously measure. So you really can forget a bit about usual fault tolerance ideas and just try to perform your measurements as fast as you can in the simpler way. Then using the properties of topological codes, this will turn out to be the best option. The first example of such surface codes introduced by Kitaev 10 years ago, well, also known as toric codes. These are constructed from four-valent lattices with two colorable faces. This means that I have a lattice in which I have 4 edges meeting at each vertex, and my faces can be colored with 2 colors, so here I will have dark and light plaquettes. Then you place a qubit at each of the vertex, above the vertices, and your generators of the stabilizer are going to be plaquette operators. For light plaquettes, we have products of sets, and for dark plaquettes, we have products of x. Then the nice thing is that you can visualize Pauli group in terms of strings. So when I draw a light string as this one, what I'm trying to represent is a product of x operators here in the qubits which the string crosses. And similarly, dark string operators represent products of sets. Then if I take products of plaquette operators, for example, these 2 plaquettes here, I will get boundary strings which enclose the area described by these plaquettes, and similarly for this product of light plaquettes. So my stabilizer can be visually described as made up of boundary strings. As for the normalizer, it's going to be composed of closed strings, that is strings, as I said before, without endpoints. Then if you take into account that crossing dark and light strings operators anticommute, you can choose your encodex and set operators from closed strings which are not boundaries, that is, operators from the normalizer which are not in the stabilizer. Then in the case of a torus, you have 4 independent basic strings with their. Then if you label properly these strings, you will get the encode x and sets for 2 qubits. So in the torus, we have 2 qubits encode. Well, of course, for practical applications, it would be much better if we could have not surface this one, which is quite involved, but instead planar surfaces. But this we cannot do unless we introduce borders. So to understand borders, I should first say that if I take an open string operator, then well, it will have an endpoint, like this plaquette here, and if I apply this string operator to an encode state, then I will get a state which will have a violation of the corresponding plaquette operator. Now suppose that I erase this plaquette with its corresponding generator of the stabilizer, so I get a new stabilizer code And in this code, this string will now belong to the normalizer. It will commute with all the placket operators that remain. And thus, now I can say that this string is going to be closed. So this is the idea. In order to get a dark border, for example, I consider that I have here a very big dark placket, and that I have erased it, so that now my dark strings can end there and still be considered closed. Similarly for the light borders. And then when I have a string which starts and ends in the same border, it will be a boundary. On the other hand, a string like this, which connects two different borders, will be non-trivial in the sense that it's not a boundary, it doesn't belong to the stabilizer. Also, I should say that two strings like this one and this one, which can be deformed one into the other, will have the same action on encoded states, because they differ just by an element of the stabilizer. Now, we can imagine a quantum computer in the form of a stack of layers, as presented by Dennis, Kitaev, Peskin and Landel, I think, in this 2002 paper. The idea is that we have a stack of layers, and then each layer corresponds to a single qubit encoded in a surface code. Then we perform this continuous measurement of the check operators to keep track of errors. And, well, for CNOT gates, we can perform them transversally, but other gates will require, well, third-time transversal action, but then also third-time code deformations and distillation, which are not so nice. Then, the point is, can we find routes which allow us to implement other gates transversally? Well, the answer is yes, of course. And this is why I want to introduce these color codes. So I will introduce them in analogy with surface codes, so to make it easier. Then, color codes are obtained from three-valent lattices with three colorable faces. So for surface codes, I have four-valent lattices. Here, they will be three-valent with three edges meeting at each vertex. This time, I have three colors for the plaquettes, so blue, red, and green. Then, I again place one qubit at each vertex, as in surface codes. But now, the generators of the stabilizer are going to be X and Z plaquette operators. So in principle, they look the same as in surface codes, but the difference is that here, for dark plaquettes, I have, let's say, X operators, and for light plaquettes, Z operators. But here, at each plaquette, whatever its color, I will have both X and Z operators. So this is the main difference between them. Now, I will have again strings, but here I have dark and light strings. Now we will have blue, red, and green strings. Again, I find an essential difference between both cases, because in surface codes, I could just deform strings, and then the corresponding operators have the same action on encoded states. But now there is a new feature, which is that I can introduce branching points in my strings, in the sense that I can combine a green and a blue string and get a red one, and similarly for a red and a blue one to get a green one, and so on. So this is different and will be essential for this implementation of transversal gates. So string operators in color codes come in two types. For each string, I can have either an a product of X or a product of Z. String operators will anticommute only if they cross have different color and different type. So here I have a green set string and a blue X string, and the corresponding operators will anticommute because they cross just at a qubit. If this string were blue, then they would commute. So not only type, but also color has to be different. Then as in surface codes, I can choose my code X and sets from closed strings which are not boundaries. So the picture is quite similar. In both cases, I have four independent strings. Note that I don't have to consider green strings because they are combinations of the red and the blue ones. But the difference between both pictures, between surface and color codes, is that here I have two operators per string, and in the end, I can see that if I label suitably my string operators, I find out that here I have 2 encode qubits, but here I have 4 qubits. So in general, the number of encode qubits in color codes is twice as in surface codes. Borders can be created in the same way as in surface codes by erasing plaquettes. They will have a color, the color of the erased plaquette. Then here I have 2 examples of planar codes with borders. In both cases I have 2 encode qubits, but as you can see the topology is quite different. In this case I have 2 green borders, then the non-trivial strings are either green strings connecting 2 borders or blue or red strings going around the hole. In this case, however, it's not enough to consider such string operators. I have to consider string net operators, which means that I will have several strings with a branching point here. And there is a big difference between string operators and string net operators. And this difference will turn out to be crucial in order to be able to implement transversally TFL group gates. The difference is that if I take the X and Z operators for a given string, they will always commute. But in the case of this string net operator, they will anti-commute. The reason is that if I deform the operator, I will see that they cross just in a point. And in this point, well, this is blue and this is red, so they have different color and they have different types, so they will anti-commute. Now with these tools, I can finally construct triangular codes. These are color codes with 3 borders. A green, a red, and a blue one. Then, there is no trivial string here. Oh, sorry. There is no non-trivial string here. The only non-trivial thing I can consider is this string net operator, which gives me the encode X and Z for the single qubit that is encoded here. Here are several examples. This will be the code for distance 3 with these 7 qubits. This will be an example of such a string net operator. This will be the code for distance 5 and for distance 7. Then you can see that these triangular codes require less qubits than their surface code counterparts for the same distance. Now finally we can see why these triangular codes allow us to perform transversally TFL gates. The fact is, well, if I perform a transversal Hadamard, I will take X phase operators to set phase operators, which is okay. Well, for the case of a transversal K, it's not so easy because I get this sign in some cases. In particular, I have to choose my lattice so that all the faces have a number of vertices which is a multiple of 4. So in that case, I will have here a plus sign, and then my transversal K gate will leave the code invariant. Now, under this condition on the number of qubits per face, we can implement transversally both H and K gates because they act as they should. And CNOT gate, of course, is granted because as in surface codes, we have CSS codes, and then it's easy to see that it will work. Thus, this shows why we can implement the whole Clifford group transversally in this particular color codes. Now, I would like to comment briefly a connection between these color codes and certain classical statistical models. In particular, it's possible to show that for certain classical three-way de-icing models, in particular models in lattices as this one with plaquettes which are triangles, you can give the classical Hamiltonian will look like this. With this is a product of over such triangles, and it turns out that the partition function for such models corresponds to the overlap of the color code and certain product state. Then for honeycomb color codes and for a square octagonal color codes, the corresponding models will live in this triangular or union jack lattices. Then recall that here I cannot perform a transversal K, but here I can. So these are different from a computational point of view. And at the same time, it turns out that the universality classes for the classical models are different, which could somehow be related. Then all this is of not much interest for quantum error correction, but however, if one wants to compute the threshold for such color codes, we will need to consider the certain random versions of these classical models, which is something we are working on. Now, you can generalize color codes to higher spatial dimensions, and to do you should first understand better what you have in 2D. In particular, you can see that it's possible to color edges in accordance with the coloring of the faces, so that green links will connect green faces and so on. And then the neighborhood of any vertex will look like this, with three edges meeting at such vertex, with each of them with a different color. In fact, it turns out that the whole structure of the lattice is contained in its color graph. So you can forget about all the faces, you can erase them, and then I give you a graph, and you can reconstruct the whole structure of the lattice from this graph, just from the coloring. So in particular, these examples here, these very simple examples, this one will correspond to a sphere, this corresponds to the projective plane, and this corresponds to a truth. It's not easy to see, but it can be shown. So with this idea in mind, you can generalize this kind of lattices to dimension D, we call the collexes. These will be graphs with D plus one edges meeting at each vertex, each of them with a different color. And if you require certain additional properties, they will give rise to the manifolds, which is what we want. Now, this the collex word stands for color complex. Complex is just a word that mathematicians will use for certain very general lattices. Now, of course, we are especially interested in the case of three dimensions. In three dimensions, at each vertex, I will have four edges meeting with this particular face structure in the neighborhood. I will have this kind of coloring. This will be an example in the three-dimensional projective space, whatever it is. Just a very simple example of what a free collex will look like. And then, as in 2D color codes, I will place a qubit at each vertex. But now I will have phase operators and cell operators. Cell, I mean a silly cell. In this case, cell operators are product of X on those qubits that lie on the cell, and similarly, plaquette operators are products of sets. Then, as in 2D, I have strings, which are collections of edges of certain color. But, they come in four colors, because now I have four colors for edges. And the new feature are membranes, which come in six color combinations, and will have branching properties just as strings do. Well, now I have three independent colors for strings. As before, I could combine a red, a yellow, and a blue string to give a green one, and so on. And similarly, I can combine membranes in such a way that in the end I only have three independent color combinations. The number of encoded qubits in a particular three-dimensional color code, it's three times the first or second Betti number of the manifold. This Betti number is nothing but the number of cuts you can do in your manifold without cutting it in two pieces. So, for example, in a three-dimensional torus, it will be three. And this number three comes from the three independent colors you have. Then, the rule for commutations of string and membrane operators is that they will only anti-commute if they share a color. So, for example, I can have a blue string and a yellow-blue membrane. In this case, they will anti-commute. But if these strings were green or red, then they will commute. And this way, in a particular manifold, here I have S2 times S1, whatever it is, I can choose three strings, and in this case, and three suitable membranes, label them suitably, and get my encode X and sets. Now, in analogy with triangular codes, we get tetrahedral codes in 3D. Of course, in three dimensions, there is no way to construct, keeping the locality structure, it is impossible to construct this three-dimensional color codes in our everyday 3D space unless this manifolds have boundaries. So of course we have to consider borders as in 2D, which are of tiny Earth erasing three cells, just as in 2D we erase Earth faces. Again, borders will have a color, so that at a blue border, blue strings will be able to end, and a certain membranes will be able to end also. In particular, if a border has a color, then only strings of the same color can end, and only membranes which do not include that color can end at it. So I get these tetrahedral codes. This will be the analogous of my previous string operators. So in analogy with this, I have these string nets and these membrane nets for the encoded set and X. And this will be the simplest example of such a tetrahedral code, in this case encoding a single qubit and of distance 3 and with 15 qubits. Then, well, I can implement the desired square of k, and the trick is very similar to Reitz-Müller codes. But the point is that I have to have my cells with a number of vertices which is a multiple of 8, and faces with a number of vertices which is a multiple of 4. Then I can see that the encode 0 is a sum over states with weight always a multiple of 8. If you study it, well, you see that you get the desired behavior for the encoding. So this way, you see why you can implement transversely this Reitz-Müller kind of gates in tetrahedral cubes. Well, finally, it's possible to relate any topological stabilization code to a system with topological order. I just take all my generators of the stabilizer and construct a Hamiltonian like this. So in particular, in the case of two collexes, I will get a string net condensate, which I have abelian anions, just as in the case of toric codes. So here, when I take third time particles around another, I will get certain global phases. In the case of 3D, I have fluxes and quasi-particle excitations, so that I have to move quasi-particles around flux loops in order to get phases. And when in general, for higher dimensional collexes, I will have brain net condensates in which the excitations are brainions, and in fact, for dimensions over 3, different topological orders are possible. So that's it. And well, I think that I can skip the conclusions. Yeah, I can read it. So thanks for your attention.
Well, thanks for a very colorful talk. I think we have plenty of time for the questions, so please.
For construction, the topology and geometry plays a very important role. So can you comment, is there any relation between the code on the lattice and on the dual lattice? Say, if you have a triangular lattice, you have a hexagonal lattice, which is dual.
A connection exists, for example, very clearly here, where, well, in the case of this classical statistical models, which you connect with your color codes, this certainly lives in the dual lattice. So in this case, we have such a connection. But from the point of view of the code, it's not as in surface codes where there is a closely, I mean, you have really to take into account duality. Here in color codes, duality plays no such a role. But indeed, it does play if you are to study, for example, error correction and so on. So I don't know if this answers. Are the same as in the problems and the good properties are the same as in surface codes. Also in 3D you will have this different behavior for membranes and strings and so on. So from that point of view, it's the same. Well, perhaps just to comment, the difference comes from, well, the gates, the underlying gates is different. You have a set 2 gates in the surface code, and here it would be set 2 times set 2 in 2 dimensions, for example.
But,
well, the main difference, yeah, it's as yes, computation.
Yeah. Any other question? Yeah.
One thing I missed is how do you perform the gates to complete the universal?
Oh.
How are you,
I didn't comment on that because it's the same as in regular codes. So you just have the same tricks as there. There's nothing new there.